Is there a secret sauce that allows digital entrepreneurship to thrive in certain environments, but not so much in others? If there is such a thing, then our next speaker, Ola Ahlvarsson, serial entrepreneur, pioneering investor, kickboxing and karate world champion, most certainly knows what that is. He's the founder of Epicenter, a digital innovation house in the heart of Stockholm for digital scale-ups, corporates, intrapreneurs and entrepreneurs. The Epicenter model for creating innovative business ecosystems has already spread to cities like Oslo, Helsinki and Amsterdam. Why not, one day soon, to warmer climates and cities in Greece? Let's give a warm Athens welcome to Ola Ahlvarsson. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And what a beautiful introduction. I wish I could be there with you, Mariana and Nikki, in person in one of my favorite places in the world. My happy place is Mykonos, Greece. And my happy mental place is actually Greek mythology. That still gives me inspiration, even it's thousands of years ago. What I wanted to do is to share what are the fruits of my first Singularity University Summit, where I started seeing the world in terms of exponential technologies, companies, and hence the need for exponential leadership. Mm-hmm. That led to creating what is today Epicenter. And Epicenter is really also a case study in how we will work and how we will live and play in the future. So I hope you will unlearn some things. I hope you will learn some things. And more than anything, I hope that maybe we will build something. Epicenter is based on the belief that if we are good at driving digital technology, we can create better societies. We believe that the ones that build in the ethics in the AIs, the ones that inspire intrapreneurs and entrepreneurs, they are the ones that can dictate how society is being created. So we started Epicenter. This is 32,000 square meters in the center of Stockholm. And we didn't do it based on a dream to sell square meter price or make money on events or whatever the business models are that we do. And I'll tell you more about that later. We built it on a bigger vision. What if we could create the heart of the digital industry and if we could become a catalyst for more success? So Epicenter, it is a membership community. So we're around 5,000 people only in Stockholm that are members, even though they're not sitting in the building. And it's created for company builders by company builders. And the interesting thing about Epicenter is that it's a much, much stronger business model for the real estate owners, for the companies there, and for us as a company. But first, a couple of words about myself. Ola, it means everything in Greek. I also live part of the year in Spain, where it means hi, so it's a confusing name. But I have been a serial entrepreneur for the last almost 30 years. I've started 22 companies. I have, pardon my English, fucked up four of them with bankruptcies and crying myself to sleep. Luckily, that was 20 years ago. But I know that side of entrepreneurship as well. And almost all of the companies have been in the intersection between a new technology and an industry I know very little about. So what we try to do is to challenge the chosen truths and build completely new sets of values and businesses. I do have a shady past, as Mariana mentioned. I was a kickboxing world champion. And this is a day at work as a kickboxer. And you know, this is a bad day at work. You don't want to get kicked there. And why do I share this with you in a talk about innovation? Well, as a kickboxer, if you think about it, you know that you're going to get beaten up 4 weeks from now, and then 2 weeks from now, and then a week from now. You cannot eat because you need to go down in weight. And you're afraid, and you can't even tell anybody because you're a tough kickboxer. So I spent over 10 years of my life beaten up every day without food and afraid. And still, I've been very happy. And still, I've been very, very focused on the goal and very passionate. And I think that's something that sport has mastered, but a lot of corporate conduct is completely lacking. The ability to really drive with vision, and that vision takes you through the hardships, the trainings, and the other things on the way. And it also made it a natural choice for me to become an entrepreneur and to try to build companies. One of the first one was a company called Boxman. In the mid-90s, it was the largest e-commerce company in Europe. We sold CDs online and home entertainment. And back then, when we started, the French had their own internet. They said, no merci, we have Minitel, thank you very much, we're not going to have the internet. And there were no payment methods. At 97, we were 40% of Amazon's size when Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon, came to Stockholm. And we met in a secret meeting with some other interesting e-commerce players. We thought the reason was obvious. He wanted to merge with Boxman. And I, after listening to his vision, I tell my friend in Swedish, we're so much smarter than this kid. He doesn't know so much about growing internationally. And we walked away. And that were probably the dumbest steps somebody has taken in Swedish industrial history. Since then, I've been building a number of different companies. And one I'd like to focus more on is Epicenter. But we have built companies like, for instance, the world's largest game for girls that like horses. Here, the innovation was that most of the games that are great are made for guys by guys that want to impress each other as programmers. Our innovation was to take the best programmers and challenge them with making the best girls game. And right now, there's 20 million girls around the planet, many of them in quarantine that are members of Starstable. And you have to be a girl, and every girl is a hero. Back to Epicenter. When we started Epicenter, we were driving with a vision, with a massive transformative purpose, that we would create a home for everybody that wanted to think innovatively, try new things, and to co-create and cooperate instead of competing. With that, we went out and we asked the most attractive companies, the Googles, the Spotifys, and so forth, what would you like to have out of a space like this and out of a district like this? They almost all said, we want to recruit the best people. We want to sort of learn and innovate. And then we went and asked the most attractive employees, what would you like? They wanted purpose. They wanted to know who else was there. They wanted to learn. And we just kept on asking until it became a movement. But we had six times as many people signing a letter of intent to move in than we had space when we launched. This has never happened before, that so much space has been taken in such a short period of time. In Epicenter, we challenge chosen truths, from simple things that like you can be there as a robot, to trying if a hangover can be cured by transcranial stimulation, to having Bitcoin tellers instead of ATMs, and all kinds of other technology. I just ordered our first lie detector. So we will have live lie detector evaluations after the events and knowledge sessions we have. We can also rent it to couples evening time that want to ask each other questions. The CEO of the real estate company is here, Mats Hederos. And when we started Epicenter, he came with a box with a key and he said, here is your key. But we instead had a tattoo artist that surgically implanted a chip in the hand of Mats. The tattoo artist, by chance, had a t-shirt saying, of course it fucking hurts. And that led to this spreading online. So we had more than 10 million people seeing our office opening. And now many of the people have chips in their hands that can get the train tickets and all kinds of other practical things, including the keys. Mats is a brave leader. An Epicenter is a home for brave leader, but it also makes people try differently because we don't judge and we're driven by a massive transformative purpose rather than making money or renting space or sending events or having members. And if you're true to this purpose, you start tapping into not the wallet, but the heart and the ambitions of the people you work with. And then money follows. So we're the most profitable and successfully growing co-working and digital innovation house, but we don't drive with money, we drive with vision and passion. We don't drive with processes and rules, we drive with vision and passion. We're also a unicorn factory. I don't know if you know about unicorns, but there's very few cities that actually produce unicorns. And Stockholm and Sweden Stockholm predominantly, is the second place in the world next to Silicon Valley and next to San Francisco. And one of the reasons is that we've created environments like this where we can help each other and support each other. And it's a very friendly and cross-industry environment where you learn something somewhere in a non-hierarchical way and you go on to build companies and do other things. We're also focusing on moving Epicenter to other markets. Here is Oslo. We're also in Amsterdam and in Helsinki. And everywhere we go, the same story is true. There is a need to find a place and to start co-creating. The politicians, the business leaders of the largest companies, the crazy startups, the academics, and the model works in other places. Another thing that we soon focused on is startups versus scale-ups, and to be very clear what we do to help startups and what we do to help scale-ups. I don't know if you know the statistics, but there's only 4% of startups that do 500,000 euros after 3 years, and only 0.4 that do 10 million euros after 5 years. So it's like betting on a demo tape from some garage band if you're betting on a startup. And large companies go wrong when they spend too much time on the startups and too little time on the scale-ups, the successful companies growing rapidly. We are a scale-up community, and we've created a scale-up community with more than 3,000 scale-ups helping each other, learning from each other, and building value. So just so that you know, to create a scale-up in Stockholm or in Athens, then it's easy to become a rap star statistically. But if you have scale-ups, as politicians, as business leaders, you can then support and do business with these guys, because these are the guys that create tax revenues and that creates employment. I think Epicenter alone has created 4,000 new jobs in Stockholm and a lot of different new companies. It's all based, and thank you to Singularity University, on what we saw when we started understanding exponential technologies. You'll hear a lot more about them. And the fact that if you are growing exponentially, you will not be a little smarter or a little cheaper if you're a chip in the future. You will be millions of times smarter. And that all industries we look upon linearly will surprise us exponentially. And I like this little example from just how Siri on your iPhone has developed. If you asked it some years ago and you said, I want to kill myself and jump off a bridge, it said, I find four bridges close to you. Now it calls the suicide prevention hotline. And I think this is a metaphor how technology will help us in the future in much more sophisticated ways. And how companies built on exponential technologies won't grow. The trained eye can see they will grow differently. And what we learned in business school will just not be applicable. We have to create other environments to be curious and to scale. This is an example of unicorns. It's purposefully old. If you look at one side, you see Spotify, Airbnb, and other companies. And the interesting thing with this slide is how many more came 5 years later, but also how much these companies on the left side have changed their industry. What do you think the others will do? And the scale is exponential. So there is not an industry, there is not a profession that will not be substantially affected. And as many others probably will touch upon today, this is the disruption curve, where disruption happens in a completely different way than the linear growth of traditional industries. And it's not an intelligence problem. All the business executives of large companies understand this. But the courage to say, we've done this for 30 years successfully, let's do something radically different, is very difficult to muster with the traditional models. And that's why we believe environments like Epicenters are needed, where you can work completely differently and challenge chosen truths. Is technology evil or good? When we first put the chips in our hands, we had demonstrations outside because people thought we were starting Armageddon and the devil marks his minion in the left hand. People were very provoked, thinking that there's an evil paradigm. Now, the social medias are challenging democracy. Is technology evil or good? Well, we believe it's as evil and good as the people creating it. And the only way we can decide to make it good is to be the ones that are innovators. Will AI steal our jobs or create more? The same is true there. It will create more fantastic jobs for people who can use the AI to do more things, better things, more efficient things. And for us to be human, to do more loving, creative, and fun things. An AI might beat me in chess, but it can't go out celebrating with my friends. And I think the way that AIs will work in some areas is that it goes from being your servant, like if you look at Waze to find a way home, at first you say, I know a better way than that, but then you realize there was a queue, there were traffic work. And then after a while, you just let Waze decide where you're going. And then after a while, you might not even look, and Waze can start planning traffic. And then it becomes your master rather than your servant. We have to look out for the areas where we allow the AI to be our master. And we need to bear that in mind when we look at the future of work. COVID has accelerated all these trends. I mean, we've gone 2 to 5 years in every industry, and especially in digitizations. So one question many people ask is, where will we work? Will we continue to work from home? I don't think so. I think one thing that has been taught here is that we will not only want to work from home, but at the same time, the offices will need to really earn the people that are sitting there, because we've proven we can be quite efficient from home. If you look at, for instance, how digital conferences are growing, how Zoom is growing, or other technologies, it's there to stay. But I think that there's something that will be needed, and we believe it's a third place. So beyond the growth of Zoom, there will be a need for spaces where we can create the best soil for innovation. And we've seen through various tests and to seeing the innovation coming out, that if you really want to drive innovation with impact, you also need to meet each other, and you need to drive knowledge, and you need to drive cooperation with different industries. So if we have the Google for Startups lab sitting close to somebody from Microsoft for Startups, sitting close to initiatives that are being made with scientists and researchers and large companies, having exactly this problem that these guys are having a solution for, then things can happen at scale. So in an ever-learning environment where people have their guard low and are psychologically safe to try things, innovation strives. We had a beautiful case where a whiskey company, a Swedish whiskey called Macmira, and Microsoft met at the coffee machine, and that led to the first AI whiskey that have looked at all the reviews of all whiskeys and created the best whiskey in the world, Macmira Intelligence. It wins every prize nowadays. We also have a no asshole policy. And if you before had an industrial model where companies exploited the planet and exploited people, and made a lot of money for shareholders, I think that there is a new model where you have to be not only a good corporate citizen, but you have to build meaningful organization where people can grow. And in those where there's psychological safety, innovation happens. So we have a clear policy that our people are rude or mistreating staff or other members at Epicenter, they're asked to leave, they're terminated immediately. And it might sound like a strange thing to have in such a large community, but it breeds a village mentality that then leads to innovation. We also focus a lot on entrepreneurship. This is my favorite entrepreneur. You can touch his hair, $1, and he gives the money to cancer research. He was asked, how do you expand your franchise? And he said, I suppose I find a bigger road. But that courage to just go out there and do it, it's often missed in large organizations, and the will to challenge chosen truths, those truths that are part of the industry. Like, for instance, this is a non-smoking flight to London Heathrow. We stopped smoking in 1988 on flights. How long are we going to say it? Is it 1,000 years? Is it 100 years? Is it 10 years? Could somebody just say that next week? Or in Sweden, there is a sport that we used to play 50 years ago and 100 years ago called bandy. Nobody plays it, nobody cares, but it's 5 minutes on the news and sports every day. There's 4 teams in the world playing it. But there's no counter-strike on the Swedish sports news. This is DreamHack, 16,000 people live, hundreds of millions of people caring about the results. Doesn't exist in traditional sports TV. So when is somebody going to say, let's forget bandy, let's focus on e-gaming? That requires intrapreneurship. Intrapreneurship, it's the art of doing completely new radical things in spite of having a good job at an existing company. Somebody said intrapreneurs are prepared to steal office supply at home and bring it to work. That's how much they're passionate about their idea. And for me and for Epicenter, there's no difference between intrapreneurs and entrepreneurs. In fact, the entrepreneurs are much more important globally than the few that become entrepreneurs. A story of intrapreneurship I like is that somebody at Caterpillar, you know, Caterpillar, they dig. They were having a board meeting and then said, so how is digging going in Finland? Well, in Finland, we dig and very good numbers. But what about Poland? Yes, Polski, we dig ski as well. Very good. Spain, muy bien, we dig. And then somebody raised their hand and said, okay, when we're done with the digging discussion, wouldn't it be cool if we made some shoes also? And the brave leader said, yes, that's a great idea. And they create a global shoe brand. I don't know how it happened. But somebody was thinking differently and bravely. And then somebody was constructing a very strange business plan. But it worked. And it was entrepreneurial. And if you as leader can unlock that power in your teams and unlock that in yourself as a leader, you can outpace the ones that are thinking and are stuck in chosen truths. But intrapreneurship is not enough. I think the most successful cases of innovation we see is the one that combine technology with a growth mindset and an organization, or even a city, if you like, that is ready to start embarking on a growth journey, but also with a business model that works. That's why Spotify works, or that's why a lot of the companies that you see growing, it's not only about technology, then it's a geek thing in the server room, or growth mindset, then it's only a training or an inspiration session, or a business model that doesn't have the scalability of exponentiality or the growth potential. So we try to look for these things, and then we focus a lot on the team. Who will work in the future? Well, this is a beautiful slide. You know these guys, they're presidents and actors and musicians and so forth. They all have one thing in common. They worked at Burger King. And I think about that when I come into a Burger King or similar. Who is going to be the president? Who creates the best company here? And I think leaders right now, we can tap into that fire and we can make people become their best. There's never been a better chance of doing that. And you need to do that with your existing skill, because people won't pop up as computer scientists and AI experts and whatever they might have to be in the future. So we need to reskill and relearn and unlearn in order for us to meet the challenges of the future. And I think that if we do that well, it will be man and woman on top of the machine rather than AIs being our masters. An equally important question is why we will work. And when we asked people at Epicenter, purpose was the most important thing for the most sought after executives, entrepreneurs, and entrepreneurs. What do we bring to the table? How can we have a positive impact on the society where we live? And how, if we succeed with that, and I, by the way, think that the next Greta is a company, we will have the right employees, the right customers, and the right shareholders. And the opposite is true. So purpose has gone from being something you add in the end or try to find in a workshop to maybe the most important asset your company can have. And when political leaders and other leaders are not stepping up to the plate sufficiently, as you've seen in elections around the world, I think that us corporate leaders and innovators need to take on that hat. But in a way where leadership is moving from being a perfect orchestra to being a jam session. Epicenter is almost like a jam session. You can actually see the mayor of Stockholm and then the global CEO of Microsoft when he's in Stockholm. He sits at Epicenter and you see teams of newly arrived immigrants with fire in the belly that we created an immigrant university for. And then there's a spectacular event somebody's having where somebody else is trying a new technology. And all of this is happening in a jam session where innovation with impact, not just trying to come up with an idea and then saying it's mega big before it is, but a jam session that drives innovation with impact. And another thing we do with Epicenter, we don't tell what we are going to do. We just say what we have done. Now, more than 500,000 square meters in the middle of Stockholm has been transformed from being known for administration and actually some bad reputation as well, prostitution, to being the most valuable piece of properties in the Nordics with Apple, Amazon, Microsoft, Google, Spotify, iSettle, and the list just goes on and on and on, because we are building on a massive transformative purpose that drives value rather than trying to make short-term money or being a silo. Because what we're trying to do is create more opportunity. And if we create more opportunity to be entrepreneurial and we get more like these guys, we can build the society we want to build. Because on a more serious note, we're seeing that the digital party and then the entrepreneurial party must be for everyone. And we heard before the previous speaker, Andreas, he spoke about being able to work in many projects in different places of the world. That's true, but at the same time, there are a lot of people that couldn't work anywhere because they're not needed anymore. So we need to upskill and reskill not only the 1% that can choose, but the 99% that we really can unlock the talent and the strength in. And here I especially see that we can do beautiful and wonderful things with the immigrant community who might have a more difficult plan to step to come into society immediately, but they've shown that they're brave, they have fire in the belly, they can best the oceans and best the hardships of being a refugee. And I think that courage can be something that can put into entrepreneurial use. I'm also speaking about the 97% companies that are started in Silicon Valley by men and only 3% by women, where we have a fantastic talent pool in all the Nikki's and Marianas out there that can create fantastic things. And as we as societies need to be much better to drive innovation and digital innovation in much more mixed and integrated teams. And in order to build those teams, you can learn from these guys. You recognize them. They're ABBA. And ABBA have all these weird clothes, because if they had weird enough clothes, it was considered culture and theater, and they got them for free. Then that became global fashion. I think that's hilarious. But on a more important note, how did ABBA form? Not because some politician or corporate leader said, in the budget for next year, we'll have one ABBA. Here's the budget for their ugly clothes. No, it's when the Swedish leadership said, let's have free music school for everybody. Let's give music to everyone so they can then learn music, play together. And some became radio DJs. Some became hobby players. Some played at cheap tavernas. But others, they formed ABBA. And the ABBA inspired the Roxette and the Ace of Base and made Sweden the third largest music export country year after year after year ever since ABBA. And I think that's exactly what Epicenter and we're trying to do in the digital community, where we become the most successful per capita in creating digital innovation. And in order for you to do that in Athens, you have everything going for you if you create the music schools and you have the fantastic other assets, such as the best hospitality in the world. You come there and you feel like what I have been doing in Sweden all my life. And you have culture and you have smart brains and you have large companies and you have people like Nikki and Singularity University ready to take charge. And you also have, of course, the divine fire as given to you by Prometheus. You all know your Greek history. He took the divine fire from the gods and he put it in every human so that there's something divine, according to myth, in every human person. And that divine fire is something that you as leaders should unlock first within yourself. But if you can do that in others, and if you can do that in a space and a place and a region and a city, then you can do that in a very beautiful way, where teams with divine fires outcompete people just going to work. And I will end with just an insight in how it could feel to leave the safety of your chosen truths, the industries that you've been in so far, and embark on an adventure. So you leave the safety of your chosen truth. You step out because there's something out there. You have a hunch, an idea. It smells good. Ah, it tastes good too. You think you're super smart. You're going to do this one alone. You take more risk. I mean, what's the worst thing that can happen? This has happened to almost all the ventures of the most successful entrepreneurs. I've been there many times. And don't look away, look now, please. It's painful, but it's painful to drive innovation. And Jeff Bezos says a long-term willingness to be misunderstood is needed, but also the passion and divine fire to just keep on doing it.